Okay. Well, welcome to this webinar, by the way, right? We're in a new, normality. So this is how we are connecting with other countries and with speakers who are in other parts of the world. My name is Paula Iglesias. I'm in charge of International Relations Office at WADE. And I am here with Professor Angelo Mananessi, who's going to be the speaker. He's the professor from the University of Bologna, right? And the University of Bologna is a very good partner of WADE. Later on, if you want to learn more information after the seminar about the relationship and the type of agreements that we have with the University of Bologna, I will be happy to answer your questions. We have also Florencia Siabota, who's the Director of Global Business Management Program at WADE, who's here with me, and Ariana Gomez, who is from the communication area, who's also helping in this webinar, right? We have lots of students joining in today. We have around 120 students now, and there are more people registering as we speak. And we have students from global communication, students for global business management, and students from the fashion area. So you're all welcome to this seminar, right? The seminar that Professor Menendez is going to speak about today is the business models of fashion and luxury companies, right? And we're going to devote about an hour for his seminar. And then after he finishes his presentation, we are going to listen to questions from the audience, right? Well, so I hope you enjoy this seminar. And well, Professor Mananelli, thank you for being here.
Thank you very much, Paola, and thank you to everyone for being here listening and watching this presentation. I'm very happy that we can really do this because we've been thinking about this presentation for some time. Then it was not possible to do it in presence, but it's very important that we go on and progress with all our activities, and among them the Buenos Aires branch of the University of Bologna is very happy to go on collaborating and doing it more and more with WADE. So today what I will talk about is the business model of luxury companies. When we talk about business, when we talk about luxury companies, we tend to think that we tend to focus on products, products that have been very strong in some respect, could be technology, could be prestige. So we tend to think and to focus too much on products like this. In fact, the business environment is full of companies that could not succeed even with great products. So today we start talking about the business model, which is how companies make money out of a product, out of a certain idea or a certain technology. And we start from the standard business model, which is what we take for granted when we think about luxury companies. And then we will see how this model can be developed and what are variations about that. So let's look at the business model, which we think is the standard one. Can you see this picture? Paola, can you confirm that you see a picture
Yes,
called the
it's
standard business
perfect.
model? Okay, so everything is working fine. The first element is a vertical integration and distribution. We all see that in the last 20, 30 years, most luxury companies developed monobrand stores. And about 25 years ago, most consulting companies and also researchers from different environments started suggesting that these stores should be directly operated, not even franchised. So it's a model based on vertical control, not only exclusive distribution, so monobrand stores, stores selling 100% the products of a certain company, but also directly operated. This allows companies, such as Louis Vuitton, Gucci, and many others, to have a direct control on the strategy. And the strategy is not just a sentence. The strategy is then implemented in pricing, the product range, display, and customer service, and many other things. So the vertical integration distribution is what we take for granted nowadays about these companies. And the reason why companies have developed this these kind of networks was to be able to cope with imitation, to cope with fakes, and to cope with heterogeneous customer service. It is very difficult to to ensure that the customer service is the same across different countries and stores when you do not control directly these stores. This exclusive strategy, so I come to the second point, sorry, is depends also on the idea of not having other products to create confusion about the product positioning. For example, if in the same store you have products that are in the same category, let's say bags or shoes, but with very different pricing, with different brands that use the very different kind of testimonials, then the identity of each brand could not be very clear. So an exclusive strategy allows to make the brand positioning clearer, and also allow the company to create a world where they can get the customer in, for example, showing customers items that are not the best-selling items, but that can be a strong complement in terms of sales, profits. So if you haven't got exclusive stores, then multi-brand stores would use opportunistically the best-selling items, not keeping in this product range the items that are not best sellers. The third point is about manufacturing and craftsmanship excellence. We take for granted that these brands are strong in that respect. The reason why we take for granted is that it is true. A brand that has a luxury positioning cannot afford not to have the excellence from different points of view in the product making. So, of course, there could be exceptions, but exceptions do not last for long. So when a brand that is positioned also in terms of pricing as a luxury product, when a brand like that does not fulfill the promise about the manufacturing quality, well, it does not last for long. Its positioning, so it can go on for a year, maybe two, but then the market in that respect at least is relatively efficient, so it's very difficult to survive that way. Then let's talk about the brand. The brand in the luxury business tends to be a dream brand, so it's a brand that is desired by people who cannot afford, which is kind of cynical. Also, it's a dream brand because it's a point at which someone can get after climbing the ladder of success, of more economic power. So it's a brand which allow people to feel that they have achieved something. Sometimes in social differentiation terms, sometimes about the personal attachment to a specific product category and brand. So some people could feel that they are successful and could feel that this idea of social differentiation is reinforced by the perception of keeping a certain brand. Other people don't care about that, and but still want a certain product, a certain brand, because they have a passion for that category, and in that category they have a passion for that specific brand, which make these brands having a very strong identity. The identity of luxury brands is usually strong, at least in terms of heritage, history. So it's not something you build in the short term. Virtually all luxury brands have not founded 3 years ago. I mean, they have a history of decades. And because it takes time to become a strong luxury brand. Of course, not the old brands are luxury brands, but I would say that all luxury brands are old enough, at least in relation with the kind of product category. So if a product category is, for example, in the electronic industry, then the life, the length of life of a luxury product can be shorter than a luxury brand in a category which is not that high tech, for example, bags or shoes. Differentiation and brand extension. Differentiation means being different from competitors. To be different from competitors, you have to be successful with one product category, very often with one specific icon item. But then this differentiation should be supported and reinforced by allowing the brand to develop its power. And one way to do it is to extend the scope of activity of the company to a larger product range, very often including items which are not part of the original product category. For example, from bags to shoes, from eyewear to watches, or the other way around. The brand extension process is very important because it allows companies to increase sales in different product categories without diluting the brand in the original product category, and this would be risky, and this would happen if the company wanted to grow to many different segments, lower price segments in the original product category. It is possible to do, but it is risky. So extending the brand to different product categories is a way to use the brand awareness that has been obtained over time to increase sales for the company and avoid the brand dilution in the original category. Multi-brand strategy for multi-brand groups. Merger and acquisition is a very important activity in all industries. And this happens at different stages of the life of an industry. For example, if you take the car industry at the beginning of the 20th century, there was a first wave of merger. For example, General Motors was the result at the beginning of the 20th century of a merge of different companies. Then there are other waves, for example, when during the late 60s and beginning of the 70s, when there was some kind of economic crisis, specifically in 1973, the oil crisis that created a big shock in the economy. Well, at that point, another wave of merger and acquisition started in many industries, for example, the car industry. So merger and acquisition is something that happens when there are crises, when there are technology shifts, innovations, and this tends to create this kind of activity. Merger and acquisition creates groups where there are different companies that do not completely merge, but these companies tend to remain relatively independent, especially for what regards brands, because brands have their own equity, their own value. So it would be crazy to destroy value just by merging companies. So what happens is that in many industries, and in the luxury industries, this happens even now. It's not surprising that we have this kind of merger and acquisition activity, and then companies have to deal with a multi-brand strategy, which is not easy to perform because, for example, you have the dilemma whether to, for example, share components, share managers, share stores, share assets, because assets, if assets could be used for different brands, of course, this would be efficient. But then the risk is to lose the identity of each brand. So developing a very effective multi-brand strategy is difficult, but this is the case of most important groups in the luxury business nowadays. Nowadays, some new luxury groups are getting created. For example, up to 5 years ago, there were the Louis Vuitton group, including many brands, many acquisitions, like Bulgari, for example, or Loro Piana. Then the Kering group, where the main brands are Gucci, Bottega Veneta, and then Richemont, with many different brands, mainly in the jewelry and watch industries. But for example, recently they merged, they acquired the Yoox Net-a-Porter, an Italian company. So these three groups were considered the luxury groups two French and one Swiss, based in Europe and stronger in the market. More recently, a couple of American groups are getting formed from Michael Kors and from Coach. These two companies acquired other companies like Jimmy Choo, Versace, Stuart Weitzman, and so two new groups are getting formed in the market. And they will have the challenge of running and developing and running multi-brand strategies. For example, the idea of keeping every brand totally independent is the starting idea, but then one person might wonder, we could wonder why you buy a company, because in the theory and the practice of merger and acquisition, an acquisition is useless if it does not increase the ability of the original company to do business. So it's not that by simply summing up successful companies, you have a successful multi-brand strategy. I mean, this is a financial point of view which is not consistent with business administration, because the theory of finance says that if you diversify, you have to diversify with liquid assets, not with companies that you control 100% and that is difficult to sell out if you don't want it. So if a group is formed with a multi-brand strategy, they have to find a way to increase the value of the whole group, not just summing companies, even if the companies are successful. And it is not always the case that all companies merged are successful. Okay, so this is the standard business model. So when we think about luxury companies nowadays, we tend to think about that. So let's go a little bit more in depth about some of these elements and how companies manage to work with that. So in the luxury business, companies provide customers with high quality products, exclusive brands, but that's not only the duty of these companies, the job of these companies. They have to understand the full value chain. For example, when we talk about the value chain, we talk about the different steps through which value is created for customers. For example, suppliers of key raw material, suppliers of important technological component, and so on. So the company that put together all the pieces is an important actor of the value chain, but is not the only one, is not the only player. And so that the focal company had to decide what is the right level of control on each level of the value chain. For example, if there is a supplier of a specific raw material or of a specific component, which is very good in doing that, which is very good in innovating and also is efficient enough to keep costs down, why should we integrate that level of the value chain in our company? It would be safe or it would be a good idea anyway to keep outsourced that part of the value chain. So the right level of vertical integration is an important decision. I mean, what the right level is for the value chain, for the integration of the value chain in a company. So it's important to understand the degree to which we have to control innovation. For example, there are companies where innovation is key. Think about the electronic companies. So it is difficult not to control at least part of the innovation and still keep the ambition of playing an important part in the industry. So in other cases, the industry is not innovating enough, so that is not an important part to control. And so on with manufacturing and distribution. One key point in this picture is that there is not necessarily a right level of control on the value chain forever. I mean, the level of control that is important to have in the value chain can change and even dramatically over time. In many cases, we have a company, a startup, which does not control many levels of the value chain because they haven't got resources enough to do that. And then at a later stage, they control more. But this is not the only reason. And this is not necessarily the only path. In other cases, we have a company that control more, and then at a later stage, they decide to control less because they find that it's more efficient to do that. I just give you an example of Bulgari. In an industrial district in the north of Italy where they produce jewelry, Bulgari started perceiving that these small suppliers were not being able to work for the next generation. So the new generation of these people were not as good as the previous ones, and as it often happened, these kind of family businesses could not always progress after after a certain generation. So they decided to set up a factory, which is not something they wanted specifically to do, to control, to have the ambition of controlling, but it was there was the need to do that because suppliers, the good suppliers, were disappearing. So they set up a factory and a school to train the people of the area that had the heritage in that sector, to train the people in the area again to go back to producing and keeping the craftsmanship, the ability to produce this kind of jewelry. So Bulgari had no intention to do that until they saw that the environment was creating some kind of troubles to the future of the company. In the luxury business, it's important to differentiate one brand from the others. If you take someone coming from Mars and you take this person around to do shopping, probably at first sight, many products in a certain category, take shoes, well, he would say that they all look the same. But in fact, people, customers do not think so. And the differentiation cannot just be about design, must be about a lot of things, a lot of elements, which are included in the product, in the service, and in the brand heritage, in the story to tell to customer. From the customer point of view, we see that there are customers which can be considered similar across countries, what we call transnational segments, people who travel, people who keep a similar position in the society. They do not, they're not exactly the same, but since they shop in airports, they shop in high streets of capitals of the world, they tend to conform to a similar shopping pattern. The traditional definition of luxury is exclusivity, excluding in the language, the word exclusive means keeping someone out. And this is the traditional definition of luxury, which comes from a long time ago. And it relates mainly to the social value, but also gradually also to the personal value of having a product. So exclusivity means mainly social exclusion or inclusion, according to whether you are in or out of the club. But there are growing values related to the personal attachment to a certain product. For example, it's very clear how Asian markets are still very much attached to the social differentiation issues when buying luxury products, whereas some European markets, at least some European of central, some markets in Central Europe are more and more related to the personal value of having a luxury product, and a little bit less social value is relevant when a customer decides to buy a certain brand or product. So the traditional value of luxury was about keeping a product and other people not having the product but desiring the product. And this is the reason why most luxury, this is very interesting for a marketing person, most luxury products that are very successful, even if they do not sell many units, because if you take, for example, Ferrari or I don't know, Cartier, they don't sell billions of units. So they sell thousands, in some cases tens of thousands. Even if they do not sell many units per year, the brand awareness is, if not 100%, is very high, and very often it is higher than the brand awareness, so the degree, the percentage of people who know the brand, than of brands that are in fast-moving consumer categories like toothpaste or coffee. So these brands that are successful over time in the luxury market need to have a high level of brand awareness to be successful, because if part of the value of the luxury comes from the social differentiation signal, the others, those who are out of the club, for example, must know the brand, otherwise there is no meaning in having. So this pattern is still very strong in countries where social differentiations are very high. For example, in the Asian countries where social differentiation is still very high, the social value of luxury is still dominant, is 90 point percent of the value that comes from buying a luxury product. So the exclusive brands are very, very well known. The affordable luxury or inclusive luxury is a kind of new concept, not new in terms of time, but new in terms of analysis, I would say. So it's been described as a more democratic kind of luxury. We talk about accessible luxury. Basically, the idea is that during the 80s, many companies found that they were able not to just to be premium brands, but also to be accessible luxury. The difference between premium brand and accessible luxury is very interesting, in my opinion. Premium brands are mainly brands that can have a stronger quality, okay? A brand with a higher quality, a functional quality, can commit a higher price, and this is a premium brand. Accessible luxury is something more, where there is some kind of social value. It's like a special treat that is recognized by a social group, a special treat because someone has been promoted, someone was successful in a certain exam or is a birthday. So this kind of special treat, when it is recognized by the others, when it start having some kind of social value, then is something we call accessible luxury. And of course, the accessible luxury or inclusive luxury has not the power of brand awareness that is typical of the most powerful luxury, exclusive luxury brands. So up to now, we've seen exclusive luxury, affordable luxury, and premium brands. These are three groups. I mean, it's not the difference is not so clear cut, but these three groups of brands tend to have a different strategy, or they tend to be perceived differently from customers. As I said, exclusive luxury is about keeping some people away, but many others desiring the brand, a very high price. And the main thing of exclusive luxury is that the price is that high, such that most customers in the world will never be able to afford the product. Let's say a big boat, a big sport car, a very, very expensive sport car, an helicopter. I mean, these kind of products are really exclusive because they exclude all the others who cannot afford. So when a premium brand can be considered an inclusive or affordable luxury is when, as I said 5 minutes ago, when it managed to keep some more social value, the quality of the product increase and is stable over time, and the price is high enough to be a special treat for most customers. So it's reachable, but not every day for so many. Let's talk about one important element: communication, advertising in the luxury market, because here there is a tension between the need to communicate and the need of keeping a little bit exclusive, if not completely exclusive. If you dilute too much, even in communicating, you risk to lose some power in this market. So communicating is difficult in every industry, because nowadays consumers are less and less sensitive to advertising. Advertising is not dead, but I mean, is not in well shape. Is not in good shape. In the luxury market, this crisis of this historical crisis of advertising is even clearer, because many magazines went bankrupt, they closed down. So the magazines luxury magazines is kind of strange thing because was kind of strange thing because they could not sell many copies because to be a luxury magazine you had to be luxurious also in the format and people don't buy paper nowadays. So in the luxury market this crisis is even clearer. So most exclusive luxury brand do not advertise directly, and this is something that they never did. Okay, they never did advertising strongly. They could position themselves in luxury magazines just to signal that they were okay, that they were around, but not to communicate aggressively. But nowadays, the brand extension is a good window for advertising. So advertising is in a way allowed, socially allowed for categories like parfum, eyewear, but not so much for $3 million car. The advertising tools are mainly for big numbers. So brand extension of a luxury company is about giving the brand to an eyewear company with a license such that the eyewear company, take Luxottica, can use a Gucci brand to produce eyewear. But at that point, it is possible to do advertising, first of all, because it's the eyewear company that pays for that. Secondly, because eyewear is a category of much bigger numbers than a category where they sell more expensive products, like the original luxury brand. So licensees are very good for that, and they contribute to keep luxury brands around such that they keep a high brand awareness without being perceived as fast-moving consumer good like toothpaste or food products, where advertising is just the rule. So this kind of tension between not being able to communicate too much, because if you have an exclusive luxury brand, you don't want to communicate too much on TV, on magazines, even on internet. But on the other hand, you need to communicate to keep a brand awareness high, because the social value of the brand is important. So the licensees have a role about that. Not only an eyewear company that gets the license for a luxury brand, not only they provide the luxury brand with some fees. Of course, it could be 10%, 5% of sales. Not only that, they also invest in advertising and they keep the brand awareness of the luxury brand high, which is very important for the luxury brand. Retailing. Successful luxury companies cannot afford to make mistakes with distribution. So this is the reason why that was the first thing I told you about today. This is the reason why they decided some years ago to go for exclusive distribution, directly operated stores, monobrand stores, which is a key way to control and protect the brand value. And it's also an important instrument, an important tool to communicate. Nowadays, with digital marketing, the big challenge is to being able to be able to integrate the digital channels of communication and distribution with the physical channel. It's not just an overlap, it's not one more channel to communicate or distribute. Is a technology that allows companies, that should allow companies to find new touch points, but keep one customer relationship with the consumer. So the importance of retailing to communicate is still there. I mean, it's still important to communicate with the stores. They have to integrate digital marketing in that. So, for example, the ability to keep a customer relationship management software is key to take customers to the store when there are new products, for example, when there are events. So it's a lot about managing, not database, but managing customer relationship management, customer relationship group and clubs. So stores communicate well. They've been much more effective in communicating than advertising because they are able to select customers better than advertising. There is a self-selection process, and then they are able to show customers the values that the brand wants to represent also by selling different products, not just the best-selling items. So we studied how luxury companies compete. We tried to classify them. We found some interesting business model that innovated in the way they developed over time. And these business models are not all the same as the standard classic business model that I presented now. They are not necessarily easy to replicate, but it's very important to study luxury companies because each one, also because of the long history they have, has got its own path to develop not only the brand, but also the business in a certain way. So this is important to understand. The first thing I want to focus your attention on is the difference between brands that start from the top, and brands that start from the bottom of the market. Most luxury brands we have today, started from the top or from